Earthquakes have now been proven to produce partial melting in rocks during an event, turning solid rock into magma for a tiny fraction of time. This is a massive revelation with far-reaching implications, and I've pondered this for years. This study was published in Nature on the 2nd of this month, and it's fascinating for a variety of reasons. For me, it's altered how I interpret the land in multiple ways, and I'll explain why. When going through this study, a million different thoughts ran through my head. There are so many implications to take into consideration, and I'll spit out just a few of the dozens of thoughts currently rampantly swirling endlessly throughout this rock-obsessed brain of mine. When these events occur, do minerals get mobilized? And if so, does that mean re-enrichment is an ongoing thing, even to this day, in areas that aren't considered to be tectonically active but that do still experience earthquakes, like Victoria? Does this emplace new quartz veins? Does it activate hydrothermal processes? I don't have the answers to these questions yet, but they change how I view the geology of the land now, because it's not really obvious if I'm staring at a quartz vein that's 400 million years old, like I'd suspect it to be, or one that's been recently deposited from past earthquakes and the associated melt. But I digress. So the study begins in four various corners of the world, where researchers handpicked four unique rock types. Granodiorite from the serene landscapes of Korea, gabbro from the rugged terrains of Belfast in South Africa, anorthosite, also from Korea, and peridotite from Italy. These rocks, each with its own tale, were about to be thrust into conditions mimicking the Earth's most tumultuous moments. In their laboratory, the scientists transformed these rocks into solid cylinders, polished to perfection. They then subjected them to a high-velocity rotary shear apparatus, a machine designed to simulate an earthquake's intense pressure and movements. The aim? To observe in real time the reaction of these rocks under seismic stress. As the experiments unfolded, a series of fascinating observations came to light. The rocks, especially when finely ground, melted astonishingly rapidly. This melting often occurred at lower temperatures that defied conventional wisdom. The researchers delved deeper, employing advanced microscopic techniques to examine the rock samples closely. These microscopic investigations revealed intricate patterns of reactions, offering clues to the temperatures at which rocks begin to melt. But the story didn't end there. The researchers discovered that water trapped within the fault lines or produced due to the breakdown of minerals played a pivotal role. It acted as a catalyst, speeding up the melting process and lowering the melting point of the rocks. Now, this second point isn't exactly news to us. We've known about water's role in reducing the melting point of rocks under pressure when it acts as a supercritical fluid, but it's new regarding this context, in that it's happening in events that are associated with earthquakes as a result of partial melting, which we originally didn't know. So yeah, this study's findings are groundbreaking. They not only shed light on the mechanics of earthquakes, but they also provide insights into the dynamic processes occurring deep within the Earth. The implications were vast, suggesting that our understanding of the Earth's crust and its reactions during seismic events might need revisiting. Now, Australia has recently experienced a few earthquakes that were strong enough to be noticed, and I've made two videos on this already. You can find a link to that in the description as well, but it's prompted many people to look into this, as little was known about it, and not much is taught in the schools here. But these earthquakes may be remineralizing ancient gold deposits. During earthquakes, as a result of this partial melting, new quartz veins may still be being formed, which, if true, would be revolutionary to our understanding of Victoria, because in our eyes, the quartz era should be from 430 to 360 million years old, give or take. But if these earthquakes are still producing new ones, then that completely changes everything. In conclusion, with its myriad of mysteries, the Earth continues to captivate and surprise us. Through studies like this, we are reminded of the ever-evolving nature of our planet and the endless quest for knowledge that drives humanity forward. So I hope this study blew your mind as much as it blew mine. Thanks for watching.